There is a difference between sex and love addiction, even that there are different kinds of love addiction.
Right, exactly. I don't see sex addiction and love addiction as two things, and I definitely don't see it as the sex addict man taking advantage of the love addict woman.
Okay.
That image we all have of, you know, this poor girl clinging to this man's ankle as he's dragging her across the floor trying to leave the room. That is not what my research has led me to believe.
Okay.
What I see is that there are essentially three kinds and that people can flip-flop between them. I see the infatuation junkie. That's the one I identify most with. Really good at romance, really bad at relationship.
Okay.
You know, just love falling in love. But after the first 6 months or so, it's just like, okay, I'm bored now. Yeah. Then there's the opposite of that, the flip of that is the relationship addict. That, you know, the butt of the old joke about what do you tell a woman with two black eyes? Nothing, you've already tried to tell her twice.
Oh.
So, yeah, I know. But it's so true, isn't it? That to some people, the pain of being alone is somehow greater than the pain of the horrible relationship that they're in.
Okay.
And that applies to men as well as to women. You know, all those guys that are living with strippers, man, you know, and hookers, and putting up with this horrible abuse because somehow just like being part of that couple is so, well, addictive, right?
Right.
And then there's the sex addict who does not really need another person there at all. You know, internet pornography feeds into that. It's sex addiction is as much an addiction to fantasy as it is an addiction to sex. As, by the way, that intoxication of infatuation, that romance addict, there's a lot of fantasy in that too. Harlequin Romance has built up a nice business model based on that.
So, let's look at someone that is coming out of addiction. How would you suggest they change their behavior? What kind of behaviors in life should they expect within the first year they come out of addiction? Is it going to be a very dramatic change? Or is it going to be something that happens a little bit over time and you sort of ease into it?
That's an interesting question. I put a lot of actual behavior modification tips in my book, things to just do differently.
Okay.
Like some of mine are, I don't date married men. Now, you'd think that would be fairly obvious. Most girls learn this in high school. I somehow never learned that unavailable means unavailable. It meant even more desirable somehow. Just a little insane in the brain.
That's the addict brain.
So I don't date married men. I don't have sex with people on the first date. Apparently you're supposed to wait. Who knew? I don't call guys. Right? I don't date guys half my age because they make really bad relationships. But, you know, if you're going to get bored in 6 months anyway. you know, you do behavior modification and some things just heal right away.
Okay.
It's like you stop doing this every day and your head stops hurting so much. But then there's a lot more subtle stuff, you know, that takes more time to start building up a little bit of self-esteem and to start building up healthy relationships. And it can be a slow process, but it's a very satisfying one. At least that's my experience.
They see it work quite often. In 12-step, in the treatment centers, people that work with therapists, they see results.
Yes. That's my experience, although I have to warn you, if you're trying to heal your love addiction just so that you can get a relationship, you're kind of like someone going to AA so that they can just get drunk on weekends and not embarrass themselves.
So there you go, everyone out there. If you're feeling alone, if you're feeling like you don't have resources, Ethelie is here for you. The book is full of a lot of humor and warmth, and we're grateful to have had you and to hear all of your advice. Thank you, Ethelie.
Oh, thank you.